gave your life for mine. Nailed to the cross, you crucified all my sin and shame. He was washed by your mercy. You are the treasure I find, my reason for living. So let my life become an offering to the one who is worthy. And all praise to the Lord Most High. All praise to the one who saved my life. All praise to Jesus Christ, our King of heaven, my King forever. You stormed the gates of my heart. The veil in between was torn apart. Now you hold the keys to the grave, 'cause you bring things to life. You roll stones away. And all praise to the Lord Most High. All praise to the one who saved my life. All praise to Jesus Christ, High King of heaven, my King forever. I lift my hands up, lay my whole life down, my whole life down before you. I lift my hands up, lay my whole life down, my whole life down before you. I lift my hands up, lay my whole life down, my whole life down before you. I lift my hands up, lay my whole life down. My whole life now is for you. And all praise to the Lord Most High. All praise to the one who saved my life. All praise to Jesus Christ, High King of heaven, my King forever. All praise to the Lord Most High. All praise to the one who saved my life. All praise to Jesus Christ, High King of heaven, my King forever.
Next song we're gonna sing is it's called Homecoming, and let me preach to you guys for a second. Homecoming. We celebrate it all the time in high school. We celebrate it in middle school. We celebrated it when we were in third grade. If you're from Texas, at least homecoming is a really big thing. And when I was picking out this song, I was like, homecoming. The time when we're gonna be with Christ again. And it's just so inspirational that if we've accepted our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, there will be a time when we get to go home. And that's super exciting. And this song goes like this.
Lord, I confess that I've been a criminal. I've stolen your breath and sang my own song. And Lord, I confess that I'm far from innocent. These shackles I wear, oh, I bought on my own.
Scarlet sins at a crimson cost. You nailed my debt to that old rugged cross. An empty slate at the empty grave. Thank God that stone was rolled away. Lord, I confess that I've been the prodigal, made for your house, but I walked my own road. Then Jesus came, he tore down my prison walls. Death came to life when he called me by name. Scarlet sins had a crimson cost. You nailed my debt to that old rugged cross. An empty slate at the empty grave. Thank God that stone was rolled. Scarlet sins had a crimson cost. You nailed my debt to that old rugged cross. An empty slate at the empty grave. Thank God that stone was rolled away.
Now sing this bridge with me. It's so inspiring.
And I see bright crimson robes draped over the ashes. A wide open tomb where there should be a casket. The children are singing and dancing and laughing. The Father is welcoming. This is our homecoming. Heaven joins in with the glory sound. That's the wrong part. Roses in bloom, pushed off from the embers. Rivers of tears flow from good times remembered. Families are singing and dancing and laughing. The Father is welcoming. This is our homecoming. Heaven joins in with the glorious sound. And the great clouds of witnesses are all gathered around. Cause the ones that were lost are finally found. The Father is welcoming. This is our homecoming. Scarlet sins had a crimson cost. You nailed my debt to that old rugged cross. An empty slate at the empty grave. Thank God that stone was rolled. Scarlet sins had a crimson cost. You nailed my debt to that old rugged cross. An empty slate at the empty grave. Thank God that stone was rolled away.
That was a great song.
Amen. Go ahead and be seated. I want to talk to you a second. You know, Thursday's chapels have been a little bit different. We brought back the games and some activities. And some of the things that we're doing on Thursday are different, and today will be different. Our guest speaker is going to come to you and share some things. You know, Tuesdays we've been focusing on preachers coming in and preaching the word to us, and I hope those messages have challenged your heart, your spirit, helped you in your growth as you walk with the Lord. And then on Thursday, like Christian was here just recently and shared his testimony, and we're bringing in individuals who aren't preachers, but are just regular people out in the world whose lives have been changed, and God's done miraculous work through their lives. And so today we're going to hear in just a moment a speaker who's going to come and share their personal journey and what God is doing in their life and what they do in their life in terms of their relationship to you. But you know, on our journey, and spiritual journey in life, sometimes we get kind of caught up in church. Oh, goodness, Mike's talking about church. You know, church is important. We drive you to church on Sundays. We want you to be there. And it's not just about hearing the Word of God, which is obviously the most important part, but it's about connecting with people and loving people and getting to know people. And, you know, God's given me this great opportunity, and I really appreciate this opportunity to being your spiritual formation leader. And I've been listening to or watching your words and what you've been hearing in your sermons on Sundays and or the sermons on Sundays. And then I look at your verses of scripture that you're telling me the meaning of them. And some of you have, you know, nailed those scriptures really well, and some of you still struggle. If you struggle with a scripture verse and you want to talk about it, I know Dr. Blevins is ready, Tim is ready, Professor Dr. Evans, myself would talk to you about those scriptures. Don't just let it pass by. Don't just finish a scripture that you don't understand and let it pass by. Let it speak into your life and change you. Thursdays, though, this semester are focused on what does it mean to actually live spiritually in this world, not just get all the knowledge. You know, you can have all the knowledge in the world but not believe. And so I hope that what you're getting on Thursdays is a chance to hear speakers come in and encourage us to hear the word, but then apply it to our lives and have change. That song was great. Perfect song for what I'm sharing with y'all right now. So this morning, I want to introduce to you our guest speaker. She'll come in just a minute after this last song. Her name is Pat McGee. She's actually a board member here at Arlington Baptist University. But she's more than that. She and her family have been engaged in being a part of this campus and pouring into this campus and loving this campus. And we are grateful. As a matter of fact, her son Justin just preached a couple of weeks ago for us. So today, as she comes to share her testimony and the journey that God's placed her on in this life that she calls a wonderful life with God, we're going to hear her testimony and what God's going to do in your heart, possibly even through some things she's involved with here on campus. Let's pray. Father God, thank you. Well, we know that we cannot do this on our own. That, Father God, we are 100% dependent on you. So today I pray, as Pat comes to speak, that God, that the words that she speaks to us will be encouraging, challenging, and a blessing. So bless her today as she comes. Pray for the team as they continue to lead us in worship today. Bring glory to yourself through all of our actions, Father. In your name I pray. Amen. Please stand.
They say sometimes you win some, sometimes you lose some. Right now, right now, I'm losing bad. I stood on this stage night after night, reminding the broken it'll be alright. But right now, oh, right now, I just can't. It's easy to sing when there's nothing to bring me down. What will I say when I'm held to the flames like I am right now? And I know you're able and I know you can save through the fire with your mighty hand. But even if you don't, my hope is you alone. They say it only takes a little faith to move a mountain. Well, good thing, a little faith is all I have right now. But God, when you choose to leave mountains unmovable, oh, give me the strength to be able to sing. It is well with my soul. I know you're able and I know you can save through the fire with your mighty hand. But even if you don't, my how busy you alone. And I know the sorrow and I know the hurt would all go away if you just say the word. But even if you don't, my hope is you alone. You've been faithful, you've been good all of my days. Jesus, I will cling to you, come what may, cause I know you're able. I know you can. And I know you're able, and I know you can save through the fire with your mighty hand. But even if you don't, my hope is you alone. I know the sorrow and I know the hurt will all go away if you just say the word. But even if you don't, my hope is you alone. I know he's able. My God is able. Yeah, yeah. Cause it is well with my soul. It is well, it is well with my
try now. Are we on?
Woohoo!
There you go.
Did you hear what I just said? Well, I'm grateful beyond words to be here and to be a part of this university. I can tell you that from someone that is on the board, that if you had a sneak peek in our board meetings, you would, of course, you know your president. We are so grateful for him and how God has moved in him and his gift of faith, and all the board members, every single one of the board members are seeking God on your behalf, and we have such unity. And so I'm grateful beyond words. grateful to be a part of it, to see you guys here and to see the reaction to the worship. That is just incredible. We all know the history of this university, its past, its heritage. My husband and I, Gary over here, he's been very active on your campus. He's the one that made the new tables in the cafeteria. Best man I know, I always tell him not to your offense. But Gary and I were college ministers for 17 years at a nearby church, not on staff. But we estimate that over the 17 years that we were college ministers there, where we got to head up that ministry, we had maybe 1,500 or more students from this campus in and out of our home for 17 years. One of those was our son. His life was changed overnight on this campus. God brought him his wife while he was here. So obviously we have a love for the campus, and we are grateful for the past, for the ministers and missionaries that have come out of this school, and I believe we will have more. But I am extremely, extremely grateful to look across this campus and to see it flourish with young men and women who are going into other vocations. And you're here to study, but you're also here to learn about who Christ is and who he's supposed to be in your life. And I say who he's supposed to be. We don't want to play church. I am so sick and tired of churchy words. And so I just want to speak to you, just talk to you a few minutes. The world is not going to be won within the walls of the church. In fact, that's not the church. We are the church. And we are called to win the battle that's on the streets, in your office buildings that you will be in, around your tables with your family that you will have. And God has all that planned out. And we are called to win people to Christ, but then that is not enough. We are called to go into the world and show the world who he is, that he is the God who he says he is. He is who he says he is. He does still move mountains. I can tell you that he moves mountains. I know that experientially. So don't think that I think that I have all the answers, but I run to the one who does. And it's not a life of drudgery like so many people think. You know, the word talks about there's this broad way that leads to destruction, and many are going in there. You can see that all over the world. Did you ever think that our world would be this crazy? Many go in there. And the devil deceives, and the devil draws people in with just enough truth. But what he plans to do is kill, steal, and destroy. He tried that in my life. So that's why I want to share a little bit about that. But there's also another place that he talks about, and I know you know what it is, most of you at least, that it's a narrow way and a straight path. And the word says that few go in there. Few there be that find it. But my hope for you today is that you don't leave this place without knowing which line you're on, and I'm going to explain that. You're either on your way to hell or you're on your way to heaven. And that's very important for us to find out. So if you take what I'm talking to you about today as being mere churchy words, or be good or God's going to get you, or a bunch of do's and don'ts, then I have failed you. But here's my plan. I want to tell you what happened to me a little bit. I want to tell you about the things that I didn't know at your age, things you need to be grounded in today. And let's see what God does with this hour. The Holy Spirit's here. He's already moved. So Holy Spirit, I do ask you to move in our presence. You are here. And we acknowledge that. I sense your presence here right now. And I thank you for the active way that you work in our lives. So we ask you to move now in power, to bring understanding and to draw us closer and closer to you. So let me just talk to you a minute. In this room, I would imagine there's many hurts, maybe hurts from the past, the presence. Maybe you are being told lies by the enemy that you're worthless, or that, hey, I'm the best in the world, both of them are bad. Maybe you have fears. Maybe you lie to yourself. Maybe your roommate doesn't even know what is deep inside of you because you think you can't share that. You think you've been bad enough that God would never forgive you. I don't know where you are, but I do know that in this room there's all kinds of hurts. And I'm desperate for you to know, and this is what's so neat, is Mike's talked about this to me personally and before you, and he didn't know that this was in my notes, but I am desperate for you to know him from not just here, but to know him here within your heart, where rivers of living water flow, and I can tell you they do, that flows from deep within, not just to know him about him, but to know God himself. He is everything. And reason will never get it. If you're trying to reason it out because you're a brainiac, you will never get it. God is a faith God, and he is real. And he has called us to prove that to the world. He's called us to prove that to the world. So God has used Ephesians 3 in my life for many years. And when I first fell before God, I was doing all those verses that maybe you see on bumper stickers, but I didn't even look past the comma in this particular verse. You may have done the same thing, that he's able to do more than we ask or imagine. And he is. I promise you he is. But I ignored the part after the comma that says, according to his power that is at work through us. But over time, he's changed me, because we don't come to him clean. We come to him and he changes us. He cleans us up. So if you think you have to do this or do that to come to God, oh, no, 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 no. You come to him like you are and he changes you. For this reason, I bow. That's where I want to start today. And I want you to know that although I'm not an eloquent speaker, I am a proclaimer of what Jesus has done in my life. And I have bowed for you. Haven't bowed for you enough. Have I travailed for you? I want to. I have bowed for you. I have been flat on my stomach before God for you. For this reason, I bow. And you'll hear me say that a few times today. But he backed me up in Ephesians. Ephesians 14 through 19 is one long sentence. It starts with, for this reason I bow. And it goes on and talks that this may happen, that this may happen, that this may happen. But what he's trying to tell us is that, oh, that you would know the love of God that surpasses knowledge. It's not this knowledge. It's far greater than that. But that you would know the love of God, and how deep and high and long and wide is the love of God. And then verse 19 says, that you may be filled with all the fullness of God. The Holy Spirit within me cries out for you. The Holy Spirit within me gives us passion for you, gives my family passion for you. Cliff, Dr. McDaniel, passion for you, your professors, your teachers. We cry out for you. I have bowed for you. And so I want to use a quick tool for you. I'm going to show you my testimony on this, but I want you to think about where you stand, on which line you are on. Because we are all on one of these lines. We're either on this line, and I'm certainly not very good at writing on a board here. And this line, until we're saved, you're on your way to hell. So I love you enough to tell you this, first off, that if you can walk like the world, live like the world, chase the world, act like the world, dress like the world, But get this next part, and it doesn't eat you up, then there's a good chance that you're not saved. There's a lot of people within the church that are not saved. So probably in a room this big, we may have some of that going on. We may have people who think you're saved and you're not. But what we're going to do is determine which line that you are on. And so for my testimony, somewhere around, I always think everybody should live to be 100, although even if you do, life is a vapor. It's short. There's other things that make us feel like we are living in the very end of the end times. But for me, somewhere around here, I gave my life to Christ. But there's things I didn't know, but for that point on, I was on my way to heaven. And heaven goes on forever and ever and ever. But this part right here is our time on earth. And while that looks like a long time, that line over there goes on forever and ever and ever. And this part, what he wants us to do is, this is abiding in Christ. Now keep in mind, I'm telling you things I didn't know. So I didn't know, that is really a bad line, but I didn't know that he had my life planned out. I didn't know that he knew who my husband was. I didn't know that he knew where I should work, what I should do. I didn't know any of that. I knew all about him right here, but I did not know that I had to be grounded in the Word of God. And that sounds churchy, and I'm going to ask you, because the Holy Spirit told me to tell you, stay focused. But what happened to me is when trouble hit my life, I didn't handle it very well. And I got off the line of my life. It was because I didn't know all these things. And I want you to know them, because trials may come into your life. And I want to reiterate right here and now that his promises are true. But I thought this line was all about me. And it's not. It's about him. But yet the neat thing, as the word tells us over and over, if we seek him, we find him. When we seek him with all our hearts, I cry out, show me great and mighty things I do not yet know. And if you seek him first, all these things are added as well. The promises are for us. And on this line are promises, but that's secondary. This is about him. This is about bringing glory to him. But I didn't know that. And so the reason I know that I was saved is because when trouble hit my life, I didn't handle it very well. I got out of the will of God as a young adult for a short period of time. And, you know, that Broadway I told you about, he put enough truth in front of me that he was drawing me to death. He's out to steal, kill, and destroy. That is true. But greater is he in me than he that's in the world. So I knew I was saved because he wouldn't leave me alone. And so I had unbelievable pain for about 18 months. And finally, one Sunday night, I fell before God, flat before him, in a little tiny house in White Rite, Texas. I fell before him. And I just simply cried out, I'm desperate. Help me. It doesn't have to be churchy words. I'm desperate. Help me. And he picked me up, and I never got over it. And he put me back on this line where this is not an issue. And so when he did, because I had dealt with fire, oh my word, I never want to be away from him. I don't mean do's and don'ts. I mean he is the way, he is the truth, he is the life. He has your life planned out, an abundant life. Why would I want to mess it up myself, you know? Sin is not fun. The world will tell you that sin's fun, but honestly, this is fun. But you have to taste and see. This is all about him, coming to him, letting him lead your life. And so for this reason, I bow for you to know it now. And I want to show you a short video by Francis Chan. I don't know if you're familiar with him, but I love the guy. And God is using him in great ways. So just watch this short video, and then I'll finish up.
I'm going to bring an illustration that this is like this stuff is just, it's crazy to me because the Bible teaches that what I do during this little red part determines how I'm going to exist for millions and millions and millions of years forever. And so why would I spend this little red part trying to make myself as comfortable as possible, enjoying myself as much as I can? Paul says, look, I'm going to live my life for this mission. I'm going to spend my life, invest my life for this moment when I cross that finish line. See, I'm going to forget about all the stuff I could enjoy. I'm not going to look around. I'm going to be like a runner just looking at that moment when I face God. Because when I face him, then I don't get this chance over again. We get one chance at this life on earth. And it can end at any second for any of us. We got one chance at this, and then comes eternity. And I'm not going to be fooled. I'm not going to spend my life down. You see, people look at some of my decisions and go, oh, you're so stupid because that's going to really affect this. I go, no, you're stupid because it's going to affect all of this. Man, I'm serious. I look at the way people live and I go, wow, that is so crazy. You are so crazy. You're gonna do that right now, just enjoy right now, not even knowing if you have tomorrow, and you think that's smart and that I'm not? It doesn't make any sense. Paul goes, I'm not going to look around at all this stuff. And it's tempting. It's tempting to all of us. That's what I'm saying down here. It's crazy because everyone lives that way. Everyone lives for the red part. No one's thinking about the millions of years afterwards. It's just a crazy deception that we can't get out of our minds. And Paul goes, I'm not doing that. Because I keep my eyes on that. I keep my eyes on that finish line. And I'm going to forget what's behind me. I'm not looking around. I'm straining. Because I'm straining forward. I'm like stretching forward for that mark. I'm going to pass this thing. I'm going to live this out. And I'm going to face him. I'm going to come before the judges. And he's going to hand me that trophy. He goes, I'm going to get it. And I haven't gotten there yet. He goes, but you better believe I'm using every muscle, exerting every bit about me. Because I'm going to pass that line well.
For this reason, I bow, and I ask you to bow before him, fall before him, let him search you and know where you are, which line you're on. So we've talked about we have to know that we're saved. Believing is not enough. Even the demons believe and tremble. So what does your life show you? Which line are you on? Are you hungry for the world or are you hungry for him? And we've talked about that it's all about him. But I want to, and that his promises are true, but I want to just quickly go over a few things that I didn't know. I'm very passionate about this. As I said, I didn't know that he had my life all planned out. I didn't know that's where joy comes from. I'd rather study than sleep. That's not patting me on the back. That's what he's done in my life. He draws me like a magnet. When you find him, you want more and more of him. That's where the joy, that's where the abundant life comes from. Doesn't mean you won't have problems or trials, but he will walk you through everyone. And that's the main point I'm going to show you is to finish up. But I didn't know the truth of the scriptures. My husband gave me this Bible a long time ago, and in the front of it, he had beautifully written in calligraphy about this book is God's love letter to us. It's filled from cover to cover with hidden treasures, buried treasures. Search for them, dig for them, and as you discover them, claim them for yourself. I did not know that this was the most powerful force in the universe. Do you? Most Christians really don't believe the Bible. This experientially is the most powerful force in the universe, God and his word. This is Jesus, sharper than any double-edged sword, able to discern between truth and emotion. So you have to be grounded in the word of God so that when trouble does hit your life, that you'll know how to react to it. But I didn't know it. I didn't understand the seriousness of warfare, that the devil was out to get me. And when I fell before him, it was the next morning that I began to put on the armor of God, but I don't take it off. I keep it on. But that was Monday morning after falling before him. And on Tuesday night, tears were streaming down my face, but they were tears of joy because the pain was gone. And it was during that time I was studying about the armor. I put on the belt of truth. I fill my innermost thoughts with that truth. And when the devil lies to me, I can say, what? Is that true? No, the truth is this. And I stand on that. The belt of truth, the breastplate of righteousness. We stand until we don't have to stand anymore. We take the shield of faith, the helmet of salvation, and I would say, oh, help me get it on ever so securely, because this is where the enemy tries to attack. And I take the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God, sharper than any double-edged sword. Trumps every single thing. There is nothing impossible for God. I've lived this experientially. I'm telling you truth. It's in the Word of God. But we don't want to just talk about it and have mere churchy words. We want to live it out for the world to see. But I didn't know. I didn't know about travailing prayer. We have been through some trials in our life. I didn't know that Romans 8, when it says the Holy Spirit groans with words that cannot even be uttered, I didn't know that. I didn't know that he wanted to travail through me. And as I travail and he groans through me, I'm telling you, it births life every single time. But I didn't know. I didn't get this one. See if you know this. I did not know that it was all God's money and he just moves it around. I'm telling you, that is the truth. I didn't know he wants to commune with me. I didn't know this love that surpasses knowledge. I didn't know that when we really understand his love, fear is gone. I have trouble with fear sometimes. But what I have to do is run to him and get the mind where it's not trying to take over. And the truth of the word lets me see that if I really believe the word and really believe him, then fear vanishes. I didn't know that he does the sanctifying, and I'm almost finished, so hang in there. But this is very important too. When he cleaned me up, again, I'm not an artist, but, and my hands shake a little bit in times like this, but here we go. That's supposed to be a vessel. When he cleans us up, he doesn't just set us on a shelf to wait till his coming. And what we want to do is seek him and get everything we need vertically. And so he pours into us, his Holy Spirit helps us and pours into us every single day. We get everything we need from him, so we're not worried about getting our feelings hurt because somebody didn't treat us good or anything. And so then we get so much of him. We are filled up with him, and then he begins to overflow us to the world around us. And I want him flowing through me like a torrent all the time. I want him flowing through me to such a place that he keeps flowing, he keeps cleaning me inside and out to the point that you can't even see me, you just see him. He wants to do that in your life. You want to make an impact on the world? It's not through the business world. It is through this. And then finally, this is the big one to me. It has been in my life. When trouble does hit your life, you need to be better than I was, grounded in what truth is. So when trouble hits your life, if you will remember this for all of your life, consider that that is A. And you go to the Word of God and you search out what does God say about this? If it's not what the Word says, then you know that whatever is happening in your life is not going to stand if you don't stop, if you seek God, if you put the Word first. So when a problem hits your life, that's A. You go figure it out with the Holy Spirit in the Word. What is the truth? And that is Z. Well, what many Christians don't know is that between A and Z, which is victory, showing, and the victory is showing glory to God, him walking through, him giving endurance, but also giving victory based on the Word of God that he is glorified, then between this time right here from B to Y, What many people don't know, and I mean Christians don't know this, there is a standing period. Sometimes it's short, sometimes it's long. My husband and I had one that was 12 years, another one that's 8. But they're not all like that. But you've got to stand until you see God glorified, His word shown to the world that He is who He says He is. And if you don't quit, if you don't faint, as Galatians says, He will walk you through it, and it will bring glory to Him. It's just so important that you know that. So I want you to know as I close that I have been broken. I've been crushed. Even recently, I have been crushed. But I did exactly what I'm talking to you about. And when we do that, you cannot faint. You cannot quit. The enemy will speak to you, God's not even real. He must not be real. He does it for others. He doesn't do it for me. But no, those are lies. You stand until you see it. And God is faithful, as we've sung about today. He is faithful. And He is a rewarder of those who diligently seek Him. All His promises are yes. And how do we please God? We can't please Him without faith. And we have to believe that He is and that He's a rewarder of those who diligently seek Him. But we need to live this out experientially. Can't just have it out here. So I started out by saying that there's probably many hurts in here. And I pray the Holy Spirit has spoken to you, because it's not through me but through my passion of Him through me that I speak to you. But I would like to ask you just to hold your hands open like this. Don't be embarrassed. Come on. Put your hands out. And when you open your hands before Him, I like to think of it as a demonstration to Him that I am releasing all those hurts, all those pains to Him. This is where I lay it down. I surrender everything. But when they are like this, they are also in receiving mode. And so we receive everything that He died to give. So I open all myself to you, inside and out. I open all that's within me. I don't know how to find you. I don't know the Bible. I don't know this or that. That doesn't matter. You come just as you are. There is nothing too dirty. There is nothing that He can't fix. Nothing is impossible. I live it out experientially, and that's not patting me on the back. That is Him through me. Do I have all the answers? Am I where I want to be? No. But I seek the One who knows all. So I open all myself to Him to receive all of Himself into me and through me. And so this should be a place where you can get in the aisle, fall before Him, fall flat. There's no embarrassment. He's God Most High. My goodness, you're Creator. You're a creature. You know what they call Christians? A new creation. We're no longer just human. We are filled with His Spirit. This is not churchy words. Churchy words make me sick if they're not lived out experientially. So I just want you to know that if you want to talk to me, my husband, our son, our family, we would be here for you, because for this reason we bow. And we will continue to bow for you. But as we go through this last song, I'm asking you, let God search your heart. My life changed when I fell flat before Him. 2 weeks after I'd fallen before Him over here, I started falling, and it's become a favored place, flat on my stomach before Him. And I started praying. This was 35 years ago. I started praying the last two verses in Psalms 139. Search me, know me, test me, know my anxious thoughts. See if there's anything in me that makes you sad, and lead me in your way everlasting. And while it's not about do's and don'ts, I ask Him to search me. And He never has stopped. And I've never stopped asking Him. And He's never stopped showing me. So I won't get there till heaven. But I ask you to let him search you right now. And again, we will continue to bow for you.
Thank you, Pat, for sharing with us. And I know the Lord has spoken to your heart today, and I know that you may need to do some dealing with the Lord with some things in your life. And, you know, we are here to help you. So as you're leaving, if you need to talk to someone, we'll be available to be there for you. I want to encourage you, we have been given an invitation by Cornerstone Baptist Church for us to have a special day with them on February 20th.